Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Adam, that's Drew. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Big night. Got your Moby.
Got your Everlast.
Got your Mark Hoppus from Blink 182.
Kelly Slater.
Comedian Jim Brewer is going to be in here. It's quite a night. What an eclectic evening we have tonight, Drew. I feel there's so much show, we just need to get started.
All right, let's go.
All right. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191, Dr. Drew, board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. And tonight, our guest is Moby. And hi, Moby.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing well.
Have you ever met the guy who announces you in a little voiceover for the trailer there?
Oh, yeah.
Dr. Drew.
It was Anderson, isn't it?
I don't know.
Does he talk like that in his regular life?
I'd like to get to the bottom of that myself, but I never thought about it.
You
and Drew, what happened to your hair? Did you part your hair or something?
No,
What's going on with your hair?
I'm growing
you
it
grew
back.
It over the weekend?
No, it's just you're noticing them.
I'm going to need that hair cut by this time tomorrow. It's horribly distracting to me. Moby, once in a while, a guest comes in here and realizes what's going on or what's not going on, and I never realize what's not going on this show. But at a certain point, right about 10 o'clock, well, the big clock said 10 o'clock, but my little computer clock here said we had about 8 seconds left. Moby looked at the clock on the wall as our headphones were off and we were talking, my feet were on the desk, and he looked back at us and he said, doesn't the show start at 10?
Aren't you supposed to be doing something
35
now?
Seconds from now. I'm a little uptight. I can't help it.
Shouldn't you guys be doing something? I mean, Drew, you're a doctor, for Christ's sake. Shouldn't you at least have a pen in your goddamn hand? The show's going to start in 30
seconds.
Prepping
all day, but you made the opportunity to point out that, in fact, once the mics turned on, it'd be exactly the same as what we were doing before, just not quite as interesting.
Marginally worse. Yeah, we prep all day, and then we relax the last 5 minutes.
Right.
I like Moby, and people like Moby, and I...
Some people do. A lot of people don't.
Really?
What's
lately,
not to like about Moby?
That's weird.
Yeah, that's a good question. Like, what the most standard criticisms of me are?
Yeah, what's the rap?
I'm self-righteous, which hopefully isn't true. I think just generally annoying seems to be the criticism leveled at me the most, yeah.
No, I mean, you're smart, and you speak slowly, and it's almost calculated. Maybe people think that you're...
smarter than I actually happen to be.
Or self-preoccupied or something. You know what I mean?
People, I'm completely self-involved.
Really?
Yeah, narcissistic to an extreme.
You are not.
What's wrong with that?
Touring definitely, though, sort of fosters a sense of narcissism. Because you wake up every day, and most of the people you have contact with either work for you or are interviewing you or whatever.
That's sort of inflation and different. Narcissism is really, you can't empathize with other people, and all that matters is your stuff.
I can empathize with other people as long as they sort of talk about me in the process.
My Moby has changed a little bit in a couple of years.
Starting to refer to myself in the third person.
Oh.
Well, you know what?
As long as you don't use the we.
Or the, like, yeah, the Moby's having a pretty good time right now.
Well, Moby is a guy who and oftentimes I make comments on this show that they start off as compliments and they go a little bit south, but then they come back again.
Okay.
But I would think that you, your personality, your look, and your music, I wouldn't think huge mainstream appeal.
Oh, no, me neither.
Yet you have it. And why? I mean, I don't mean why, like, why you suck. I mean, what do you think the secret of that success is?
You know, for the life of me, I have no idea. Because, I mean, I'll read interviews with other musicians. Like, I was reading an interview with Linkin Park.
Right.
And I like, the guys in Linkin Park are great. They've made a really good record. But in the interview, they were talking about how when they started the band, they wanted to be rock stars. They wanted to sell millions of records.
Hmm.
And I never had any aspirations like that. Like, my thought was, like, I'll make music, and if I'm lucky, I'll get signed to some, like, small fly-by-night record company that'll sell 10 records and go back to being, like, the fry chef at Burger King.
So maybe it's the fact that you're sort of not central casting rock star and that you actually didn't want to be here is what forced you here in a certain cosmic way. Don't we always need one guy who doesn't want to be here?
Well, no, specifically here, hanging out with you guys. This is nice.
The Moby does?
Yeah, the Moby's enjoying himself a lot right now.
Don't piss off the Moby.
But maybe the people that want to be where you are or pissed off that you can't enjoy it or don't love it or something. You know what I'm saying?
I enjoy it, but it feels more like a social experiment. And I don't feel any sense of entitlement. You know, I think a lot of musicians and public figures, one of their downfalls is also this, like, almost pathological sense of entitlement that
they
have. You know?
Absolutely.
And, you know, if I start to feel entitled, I just look at myself in the mirror, and any sense of entitlement I have just flies out the window.
And the Moby, what... do you have any hobbies that are like that you would consider uncreative?
Snuff films?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, there's a certain
making,
artistry
appreciating,
in those.
Collecting.
What, sure. What was your family of origin like? What were you grow up like?
It was really odd. I grew up in a very sort of conservative New England family.
In where?
In Darien, Connecticut.
Oh my God!
Yeah, I know.
Darien is where Stepford wives live.
I think didn't we talk about this on the TV show?
Possibly. I don't, this, you know, well.
All right, but keep
that
going.
That was like 6 years ago.
Drew was really, he used to get pretty coked up before because the camera freaked him out. Uh-huh. I mean, it's cool. It was medical grade stuff.
I was freebasing before I came here tonight, so.
This is starting to sound familiar, so keep
right,
going.
There, yeah.
I grew up in a very, very wealthy conservative town, Darien, Connecticut, but my mother and I were really poor. So my whole life, my mother was a hippie as well. You know, she painted and played piano in a rock band and smoked a lot of pot. So I had this strange experience where I would go home and my mother would be rehearsing with her band in the living room, and I go to friends of mine's house, you know, the houses of friends of mine, and their parents were CEOs and, perfect Stepford wife type family. So it was this odd dichotomy.
Huh. And where was your dad?
Oh, he died when I was two.
Of what?
I drove into a wall.
Otherwise, it was a complete fluke accident? Or?
I think so. No. I was only two, so I don't know.
Did you have stepdads or other?
My mother remarried actually someone who looks a lot like you, which is disconcerting.
Scary. That's got to be weird.
And
not bad.
When I was, but I, that was when I was like 22.
Not much in the brains department, but he's good looking.
No, she remarried when I was 22, so I had already left the house.
But they're not male figures through your life or anything?
Well, grandfather, occasional like Hell's Angel boyfriends.
Oh, that's what I'm looking for.
Now, so do you have more guy friends now or girlfriends now?
Equal. I think I tend to have more female friends than male friends.
All right.
Is that female fair? Friends?
Female friends. Did I have a Freudian slip?
No, you were there. Okay. Drew, don't ride the Moby.
No, I would that makes sense, right? Because your dad went there.
Yeah, I grew up surrounded by women.
Yeah.
All right, let's take some phone calls, and the Moby will join in.
We can continue this psychoanalysis later.
This is one about people's feelings about Moby. You want to take that one?
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Anton?
I dread this.
The Moby, I beg your pardon.
Anton?
Yeah, what's up?
You're 15, what's up?
Hey, Adam, Drew, Moby, what's up?
Hi, how are you?
I've been a big fan of Moby for, like, a really long time, ever since I've been into music. And I've listened to Eminem. I don't really enjoy him himself, but his beats are pretty...
What is that? Eminem. I think Moby now. I see.
Yeah, okay, go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, and his beats are cool, but I don't like him. And I was wondering how Moby felt about his new song, which this is Moby and Techno, which Moby doesn't really do anymore. But
to be honest with you, more than anything else, I think it's kind of funny. And the video where he dresses up like me, I mean, I'm certainly not offended. I'm offended by some of his lyrics, especially the sort of misogynistic and homophobic lyrics, but I'm not offended by the fact that he disses me. You know, I think the video's funny. I actually think Eminem's really talented.
Yeah.
I take exception to the fact that his lyrics are so virulently misogynistic and homophobic.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't really have a problem with him. I think he's talented and interesting. But, as I said, I'm certainly not offended by the fact that he disses me.
All right, Anton.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
All right. Good times there, buddy. All right, let's talk to Jeff. Jeff?
Yeah.
21. Wait a minute. How old are you, Moby? Because I know Eminem calls Moby old.
Yeah, I'm 19.
Because I got the feeling maybe younger than both of us, which means we have to kill ourselves.
I'm 36.
So, oh.
Yeah.
38. So. Drew's 100 and what?
No. Timeless.
Jeff?
Oh, before we get to Jeff, can I...
Sure.
One time I was on your show, and we got had a conversation with this guy that was so disturbing, I still remember. We were talking to a man who had a goiter or some sort of growth in his testicles.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were talking
to him. That's a routine call on the show.
And the conversation was going along very smoothly, and at one point you asked him, well, how large is the growth in his testicles? And he said it was, like, larger than a softball.
Oh, yeah, an orange or something.
Still, I have this visual image in my head.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I go to bed every night with that and many other visual images.
Okay, sorry,
from this
I didn't
show.
Mean to interrupt, Jeff. I just.
Softball's not so bad, unless it's rock hard.
Yeah.
Because the softball can be
so I shouldn't.
Hard.
I shouldn't be worrying too much.
Softball's not okay. bad. Unless you have some lesbian trying to hit it with aluminum bat. In which case, and that weird visor they wear because...
I know a lot of government, like politicians, who pay good money to get hit in the testicles nice. By lesbians with aluminum bats.
Very nice.
Moby, are you as disturbed as I am by women's softball with their refusal to wear baseball caps and they wear those funky visors?
I haven't seen it. This is the first I've heard about it.
It bothers me. Don't watch ESPN3 at like 4 in the morning. You will go out of your mind. Mark?
This is Mark.
Yes, you're 30?
Yes.
And your penis was burned by acid?
Yes.
So what are the ramifications of that? Is it like permanent scarring or...?
It's going on 2 years and, just blotchy discoloration and...
But is it scar? I mean, after 2 years, after being burned with acid, it should be healed and maybe some scarification, but it should be fine pretty much, right? Am I mistaken? Uh-huh.
It all turned black and then peeled after about a month. And it with friction, it inflames. It's like the opening of the urethra melted inside out.
Ooh, bad times. True. Did this guy sound like the Silence of the Lambs killer in real life,
though? No, he seemed quite
Buffalo Bob?
Just his radio
Buffalo
voice?
Bill?
Yeah.
No, he's fine.
It puts the lotion on its skin and puts the lotion in the basket.
I think he's just a little freaked out talking about it.
All right. Mark?
Yes.
So, now, the doctor who did this to you, first off, what happened with the acid?
As soon as it was poured on, I turned white, ghost white, and started shrinking up.
And what was the mix-up with the acid?
I believe it was the acid that's used to treat warts. Vinegar to check for warts.
Bad times.
So the malpractice suit. You're set for the rest of your life, right?
No, unfortunately, I'm not.
And
it would seem to me that if a doctor pours acid on your penis and blackens it and ruins your penis for the rest of your life, that you would then sue them for millions and millions of dollars. It's flagrant malpractice, isn't it?
There's a cap on malpractice.
A cap on malpractice? See, that's what you get voting for George Bush.
And so did you get some money?
It's still pending.
How much are you looking to get?
$250,000.
All right. Well, that buys a lot of vitamin E. I mean, so now you're putting, what, is there a daily ritual that you do with your penis?
I just spend most of my time naked because clothes hurt now.
But let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Just in general. If someone came up to you on the street and pulled down your pants and poured acid on your penis, you would sue them for everything they were worth. So why should there be a malpractice cap? Why should he only get $250,000?
You wouldn't sue them. You'd put them in jail for a criminal act.
But you could also sue them,
it depends. If, like, Oprah Winfrey did it, you'd have a nice settlement, nice payday. But if a homeless drifter did it, you might not get anything out of them.
But let's say there's so many different ways to go with the call. Let's stay focused.
Because this happened to a friend of mine.
I'm just trying to envision, like...
Oprah.
If Oprah...
This guy's set for life.
If Oprah came to me and poured acid on my penis...
It'd be the best day of your goddamn life.
I should stop because I'm getting a little turned on thinking about Oprah and penises.
Mark, did you get strung out on pain medicine or something too in the course of all this?
Could you repeat that?
You got involved with pain medication in the course of all this?
Yes.
This was the interesting part about this, and then this. There's so many different layers to poor Mark's call. I don't know where to go.
Mark,
with it.
Okay, I didn't talk to Mark in a cafe by the Golden Gate Bridge like you did.
Half Moon Bay,
but. Sounds I can tell romantic. By Mark's voice that something's up psychologically in a big way with Mark. Now, did this happen a couple of years ago?
Yeah.
And he's sort of living it like a Vietnam vet? It's like the deer hunter with his penis? I mean, look, I don't wish acid being dumped on anyone's penis, but it happened. It's been treated, as the Moby said. It's at the point now where it's not a festering open wound. I mean, there's some scar tissue, there's some issues, but it seems like there's a lot of psychological damage too.
Well, and what I was trying to make to him is that there, because he is an addict, that addicts get this pain reward mechanism going, where a pain that causes someone to take an opiate becomes a very highly rewarded and entrenched pain circuit. It's real. It happens. and causes this persistent pain many times that is basically driving the brain back towards the reward of the opiate. Mm-hmm. And if somebody's recovery isn't going well, it's not fully intact. And he mentioned to me some other things about that he'd been given that could kind of perpetuate this. And I was telling him to stay away from pain managers and work on his program. And maybe things that can break these circuits. They're not good, but there are things out there that can arrest these circuits.
So it's like neurological Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah, it's a some neurological circuit. Yeah.
That, you know, Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah, yeah. You sympathize
you fall in love with
your captors.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like, we could hang the Moby. Okay. I mean, you were talking about Stockholm syndrome.
Make obscure references that no one else would appreciate. That's nice.
We go on vacation. We get bored and we leave 2 weeks early, and we sit around and we just hypothesize on the plane about who would dump who would want to dump penis. Acid on her penis. Yeah. Yeah, like who? I would want the Sultan of Brunei to do it. Oh, good one, good one.
How about actually? Well, the richest woman in the world would be Queen Elizabeth.
Oh, oh really? I would like her to do it.
Queen Elizabeth, but in a nice regal setting.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
But you never win a case against her. So you really want Prince Charles to do it?
Yeah,
yeah. Queen Elizabeth. She's probably she's royalty and all.
She's
the Sultan of Brunei. Same thing.
Yeah, but but she's so well liked, so well loved. She just.
The Sultan might pay you off.
But he might
kill you, too.
Prince Charles.
Bill Gates.
Yeah, what about a Forbes or,
Bill Gates.
Yeah, Gates or maybe even a Don King. You know what I mean? Because that might be interesting. A guy with the crazy hair.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with a guy who wears a chain outside of a suit, you know, dumping acid on your penis for a change. David?
Yeah.
You're 25.
Yeah.
What's up?
I actually corresponded with Moby in college via email, and I'm sure you probably talked to a lot of people, kind of when you're less popular, Moby, but I just wanted to say thanks.
You used to talk to people. Right. Now you won't talk to anybody.
Now I'm the Moby,
The Moby.
I'd like to be referred to as that, please.
I went to this hardcore Christian school, and where you signed a thing when you entered, it's called Wheaton College. I will not dance, drink.
Wheaton's a business school, isn't it?
Yeah.
Wheaton in Illinois.
Okay. Oh, different Wheaton. Okay.
I was going to say, wow, Wheaton.
Christian business school is kind of an oxymoron.
This, by the way, I don't want to digress too much, but Drew, I've harped on you many times that we need to have one name, such as, it Minnesota? Was like Duluth or where? No, not Duluth. There's one in New York. There's one in Minnesota.
Rochester.
Yes. There's a lot of confusion in this country.
Springfield.
Springfield. That's, yes.
Way too many Springfields, Rochesters, colleges that share the same name. Come on. We're creative. We're creative, Brady. Let's just do the one because it's always confusing. You name the one. Everyone pictures something else. Drew and I almost got in a fist fight on the plane over Rochester. I was like, are you high? It's in New York. He's like, it's in Minnesota. And we're both right. Really? Okay. Remember that, Drew?
So you went to Wheaton. Yeah. You went to Wheaton Crazy Christian College.
Yeah, and you know one of the rules is you can't be gay, and you were actually probably the first person I came out to and could verbalize it to, and you really laid back and chill about it, and you kind of had a whole interesting non-dogmatic vibe with Christianity, and I'm not really on the Christianity tip these days, but you made a lot of sense to me. You kind of helped keep me from jumping out a window.
Oh, jeez.
Well, it does seem, I mean, one thing
really
that's
cool, and I appreciated that. And
thanks.
I was working at the now defunct Sony Music Work Group a while back, and you came in with Liz Brooks, and I didn't have the balls to say hi.
Oh, you should have. Yeah, I remember we almost signed with the work group.
Yeah.
But, and this was, what, 5 years ago when you were corresponding?
Four or five years ago, yeah.
Yeah, something like that. And anyway, you were just super cool, and, you know, your intelligence and your music and all that have inspired me. I'm a musician, too. And so, anyway, it's very cool. I'm now getting my music in some movies and TV shows. And,
wow. Nice.
Anyway, so thank you.
Well, thanks.
I'd love to send you some music if that's not...
Yeah, you'll send it to... there's an address on every CD. 333 West 52nd, apartment 1003. That's my home.
That
come hang over.
Yeah, it's a dumpster. It's on the corner.
I'm sure that'll go in a stack, but that's cool.
Well, no. Will you? If music is sent to you, you may have somebody listen to it.
It might take a while, but I try to listen to everything.
Well, here's the point. It couldn't be worse than not sending it, could it?
Yeah.
Oh, it could, because what if you're bringing the CD to the post office and you get hit by a bus?
That's right. Don't do it.
So maybe
hire a Mexican day laborer to run it down.
Yeah, but then what if the Mexican day laborer ends up being a serial killer?
It pulls a shiv on you?
Yeah.
Matt Moby's always looking on the bright side.
That's very interesting. It's true. You should really refrain from all movement and just stay in your... Put a diaper on and sit on your sofa like I do and wait to die. All right, let's hear something.
That would make such a nice T-shirt. Just like, just put a diaper on and sit around and wait to die.
It's a new song.
Mm-hmm.
Other hilarious tales after this.
Hello, who's this?
This is LoveLine.
1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine will be right back.
LoveLine is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
LoveLine will be right back on 100.5 The Zone.
And now back to the sex talk. It's LoveLine in The Zone.
Hey, everybody, it's the LoveLine. Yeah, we're back on the air.
That was quick.
Yeah. Time flies when you're going number two. Hey, it's LoveLine, yeah. Dr. Drew Moby is here tonight.
Honey, different
33.
Ones.
Honey. Yes. Hi, what's up?
Well, I had called in. I'm calling from Denver. I'm working here, but I was just
in Denver yesterday.
Oh, yeah? Well, I currently reside, though, in Rancho Cucamonga.
Okay.
And I've been with my boyfriend for 10 years. We mm-hmm. moved to... I was broken up with him. I moved to California with him 4 years ago. And while I was broken up with him, I was with a guy that was, well endowed. And I told him about it. And then he became obsessed with having... threesomes with other guys.
Is he interested now? Is he interested in the other guys?
Well, that's the thing, is that the first guy that we were with is now my best friend. And
also, you guys have had threesomes with other guys.
You've been doing this.
Yeah, I had.
Does your boyfriend have sex with the other men?
Well, no, but the thing is that he's like obsessed about just talking about it. I'm in here in Denver, and he's obsessed with me sleeping with my ex-boyfriend.
So he likes seeing you with other guys.
Yeah.
That's his thing.
Yeah, but he seems real fixated on the guys.
The endowment part?
Yeah, exactly.
So he's interested in seeing you violated by guys with large penises.
Exactly.
But does he... When you have the threesomes, does he have any contact, any sexual contact with the men at all?
It
tells him off,
you know, he participates, but not no direct.
What's he doing? What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, we do, you know, things like, DPs and
DPs?
Things like that.
Double penetration.
Yeah.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
So are they both in the same orifice or
No.
Is that possible?
How dare you?
I've seen it. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
My God, you've seen
it. It's impossible.
All right, well listen. Wait. So he's really interested in seeing you sort of in pain.
Well, I don't know if it's really in pain, but maybe it's there's a certain level of disrespect.
Degradation. Violated.
He's exactly. Right. And I think that he likes.
Did you say degraded?
Yeah. What did I say?
Are you making up words again?
Oh, degradation.
Degraded?
Degraded, yeah. Sorry.
He just wants to see women as being whores because of the way that he was raised.
And how was he raised?
Well, he had a real alcoholic mother, and his sisters have never worked, and they live off of men.
All right, so what's your question? All right.
Well, I was wondering how can I tell whether I think that he may have some latent.
All right, hold on a second. Do you have any kids with this guy?
No.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah, that's what I say too.
All right, don't use protection, please.
Yeah, I definitely.
Okay, here's the thing. I don't think this guy. I don't think any of us think he's gay.
No.
But I think he's angry.
Oh.
And he's somewhat abusive. And this is going to be a problem.
Well, does he force you into these situations, or does he just sort of...
Sometimes he does, yeah, because
that's creepy.
He's telling me that I don't have enough experience and things like that, and most of the time I go out with my friends
or even my ex-boyfriend,
make up stories, and they're not even real, and I email them back to him.
All right, honey.
So he's psychologically abusive.
Honey, here's the real question, though. What are you doing with this guy?
Why? Why him?
Well, I'm just basically... I hate to say this, but he's basically my sugar daddy because he doesn't really have sex with me. I can have my cake and eat it, too. And I'm going through school right now, and I work part-time, and so...
Hold on. Since when is double penetration eating your cake?
And not having sex with him?
Well, that's the thing. That's the only times that we ever have sexual contact.
Oh, man. I'll tell you,
how old is this guy?
He's 78. My age. He's 33.
All right, so it's not a relationship. You're sort of quasi prostituting yourself to this guy.
Yes, please. So try to salvage a little bit of dignity and get out of this relationship.
But it is what it is. It's an objectifying. She's being objectified. She's accepting being objectified. He's objectifying her.
Right.
All right. Not a good thing for anybody.
Well, they've got this sort of, I mean, moderately benign give and take.
They're both getting something out of this. There's no doubt about
it. Right. They're both adults.
It's working for them.
Mutual parasitism.
But it's psychologically really a sad situation.
Nobody's getting hurt except for the guy on the bottom who's getting the balls.
I've often wondered about that. Yeah.
Robert?
Hello.
You're 15?
Yep.
Your parents are Christian.
And they think I worship Satan, apparently. And
this is some
cutting problem.
This is sort of
what
we were
problem?
Cutting.
Cutting problem.
This is sort of what we were talking about earlier.
Right. My parents
cutting like cuttings from newspapers, cutting oh.
My
like
parents
cutting
thought
yourself?
I, yeah.
Yeah.
So are you Wiccan or what are you?
I'm trying to decide whether I'm Wiccan or pagan.
Are your parents ultra super Christian?
No, but they don't quite understand.
Pagan worse than Wiccan. And Wiccan's really fat chicks that recycle. Hmm. I think it stands for that. I'm trying to figure out. Is it women in recycling?
It's usually white, is it?
Yeah, white chicks who recycle. White fat chicks who recycle is basically what Wiccan. That's as much as I can tell from the religion. Because every time I talk to a Wiccan, it's about the earth. It's about giving back to the earth. It's never about spells or anything good. Drew, work out the...
An acronym for Wiccan?
Yeah. Yeah. It's got to have recycling, or something about the landfills and fat chicks in there. That's all. Hey, Robert.
Yeah.
All right. So your parents screwed you over, and now it's payback time, right?
I suppose.
Yeah. All right. Well, at least you know what you're doing.
Did you ever? Okay. Here's a strange question. Did you ever cut yourself when you were young?
Oh, me?
No, Drew.
Adam.
Sorry.
No.
There was a visual thing going. Yeah. Yeah, there's when you're visual on the radio, it doesn't quite work.
Yeah, when you point, Drew does a lot of that. Drew does a lot of this one, too. I don't know.
Because when I was a 15-year-old, I played in a hardcore punk band. And what I discovered, because one of my heroes was this guy, Darby Crash. Remember Darby Crash? And he used to always be cut up. And so one day, some friends and I got razor blades, and we cut ourselves. Not that we were nihilistic, not that we were Wiccans, pagans, Satan worshippers, whatever, but because Darby Crash had done it. And the thing that surprised us the most is it didn't hurt.
Right.
And so more than anything else, it was a way to like freak out your friends. And it didn't last very long, a couple of weeks of freaking out your friends. But if I had been my parents at the time, I would have been horrified to think, oh, they're cutting yourself with razor blades. And the truth is, you find something that doesn't really hurt and can freak out your friends. So, yeah.
Well, a lot of these kids get sort of a rush from it. They feel kind of high from it. Mm-hmm. And so it's another way of sort of releasing aggression and managing unpleasant affect states.
But
when their brain has everything else at their disposal.
I guess one question would be, how bad, when you're cutting yourself, how badly are you cutting yourself? I mean, like severing limbs?
Just my wrists.
Oh, that's nice.
In the interest of like just doing something dramatic and a little bit bloody, or actually trying to hurt yourself?
I don't know how to exactly explain it. It just seems to help.
Well,
one of the reasons Drew is being quiet is because he's still trying to work out the acronym for Wiccan.
He's got something here.
So meanwhile, I'm inflicting this like grave psychological damage while we're trying to figure out an acronym for Wiccan.
White, isolated, chubby chicks.
Okay.
Oh, the isolated was a stroke of genius, Drew. No one could have worked that eye in for the Wicca. Oh, my God. Oh. All right. Fantastic. Hey, Robert.
Yeah.
Tickled pink with that acronym. But listen, buddy. What did they do to you growing up? I mean, They just pissed you off with their religion, or what'd they do?
Well, they pretty much ignore me.
All right, and now...
Were they real aggressive with you at one point?
Yeah, they tried to force a lot of things onto me.
Right. Let me give you a little life tip, Robert, as you know I'm a genius. Yes?
Sure.
Sure is a resounding yes.
All right. Here's the thing. you want to get your parents to notice you because they don't really notice you. So you start doing, you know, antisocial behavior. You get into the Wicca. You get into the paganism, and you start cutting on yourself and all that stuff's great for a little bit. And your parents will kind of notice you. They'll notice you by, you know, sending you into a padded room and that kind of thing. But then later on, you get out of the house and you get people to notice you, but it doesn't work. You don't make any money. They arrest you. It's just it's a crappy phase.
Well,
just screw it.
My parents don't even know about the cutting, so.
Okay, you're going to make sure they find out soon enough, though.
I hope they don't, actually.
Why?
Because they're going to freak out.
But ultimately, that's what you want from them.
Yeah, but the thing is that they freak out, then they institutionalize you, and then suddenly you're on all sorts of drugs that you don't actually need, and, you know.
Well, I'm already on Celexa, so.
All right.
What's that? Is that like one of those exercise?
You're 15. What are you in the 10th? Going into the 10th grade or something?
Yep.
Okay. Can you dress normally? Make some friends. Do well and go far away to some college one day.
Dress normally.
Yeah, I just mean don't wear all black eyeshadow and all that crap. You know, and get beat up by jocks.
I don't do makeup thing.
Okay. And what do you wear?
Mostly, darker clothing.
Right. Mm-hmm. And do you ride a broom? You wear a pointed hat?
I was a disturbed...
Actually, I ride a vacuum cleaner.
Yeah.
I was a disturbed little punk rocker in high school, and I turned out relatively okay, apart from, like, the pathological low self-esteem.
They've gone out and studied kids and, you know, kids that come up punker, kids that come up hippie-ish, and the highest risk for becoming a punker was having parents who were hippies.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a form of rebellion.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. I guess what it is these guys have tough lives already.
Mm-hmm.
And through their dress, their appearance, and their actions, they actually invite more trouble for themselves.
But they're also, then there becomes this sort of like sense of like defiance. And like it's one thing to be victimized for things you can't control.
Right.
But it's kind of empowering to be victimized for things that you've actually, like situations you've engendered.
That's
you're,
a very
you're
good
in control
point.
Of that. That's
right.
Very good
you're,
point. That's what kids do.
You know, when I was 15 years old, I was such an utter loser. I mean, you know, so I started, you know, piercing my ears and dyeing my hair. And
well, how
suddenly,
did you wear your hair? I would love to see some pictures of you.
But he just explained something to us. We've been trying to figure out, excuse me, for a long time. Is that
I know.
They want to evoke that as a way of maintaining control over the victimization.
Yeah.
And the negativity.
I gave him credit.
Yeah,
I thought it was profound.
And also suddenly you get attention where there was no attention before.
Yeah. But
and you're in control. And you cause it.
It's sort of attention on your own terms, and no one can figure it out because it's negative attention, but yet it's attention that you control.
Yeah.
And that is interesting.
And there is something really empowering in being able to push people's buttons so easily.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially with something as arbitrary, like when I was 15, 16. Yeah, suddenly I came to school with bleached bike hair with little leopard spots in it. It looked awful.
Right.
But so suddenly people are, you know, yelling at me and I'm getting all these hostile reactions. And I even got some positive reactions for something as arbitrary as hair.
Mm. Right.
And so it's like, for me, it was kind of educational to realize that you could do something that's sort of ontologically inoffensive and arbitrary and get such heated reactions from people.
Yeah, I think what it speaks to in other people is they tune into the part where you want a reaction oblige it.
Right.
They oblige you with it. But it's a very good point about the being able to control that. Josh?
Yeah.
You're 17?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so whatever. As far as Robert goes, I don't know. Doing whatever's going to piss off your parents most while you're living at home is really a bad idea. So just
well, especially if they're going to institutionalize you.
Right.
Yeah.
Josh?
Mm-hmm.
So what's up, buddy?
Every time I eat a fruit, I like have very terrible gas.
Yeah,
very terrible.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, terrible smelling or terrible feeling, uncomfortable.
It's like very long and it smells.
Isn't that satisfying though?
Yeah.
Oh, Adam is jealous now.
Yeah.
Oof.
Yeah, I would eat that horn of plenty every night if I was you. I'd suck it from the small end.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Josh.
So, is it causes social problems?
It's been happening to me like every. Like,
hold on a second. First off, if Josh is 17, then I'm in my 80s. This guy sounds like he's 11. I make poopy long and it's smelly. And I keep hearing the clicking going on, but Josh eats some fruit and he gets gas, and he's like, "Is it painful? Or it's long." Now, look, you think You think this kid's retarded? Are you actually 17, Josh?
Yes, I am.
You better be good looking, or you're not going to get laid for a long time.
Hopefully.
Because of the gas, or
he sounds like he's 11. Josh,
mm-hmm.
You make smelly sometimes.
Yeah, I've like been doing it for like the last 5 days.
5 days. What kind of fruit have you been eating?
Peaches and plums.
Why don't you stop?
What happened to his voice, by the way?
I know.
Is it peaches and plums, like, in conjunction with anything else? Like, because this is for personal reasons.
Yeah.
Like onion rings, stuff like that.
Outstanding.
Onion rings, though.
Well, that's what happens.
Here's what you need to do. You get yourself a blender, some peaches, plums, onion rings, maybe a big jar of mayonnaise, and make yourself a smoothie out of all these things before you go to school. And then impress people with your flatulence.
Impress your friends.
Josh, you all right? Do your friends like farting?
They're okay with it.
The thing is, farting's funny.
3 months.
Unless it's indicative of some sort of pathology.
Are you having diarrhea?
Not yet.
All right, you're good times about it. Don't eat the fruit that gives you the gas.
That's very simple.
This is a jack off. And I agree with Moby. Farting, nothing funnier. Mm-hmm. That's the only time I laugh when I'm alone is when I fart. I will actually audibly laugh at breaking a good.
Do you give it that?
Yeah, I do. And I oftentimes look around hoping that there's somebody I can share this with. Yeah, nothing better. You ought to. I don't know, Moby. You ever sample any farts?
Usually, I can't really plan them. That, you know,
I know, but
as far as like farting in my studio with a microphone ready and the sampler ready to record,
you spend a fair amount of time in there. Seems like if you could get like one of Bowie's biscuits and sample.
Maybe
I wonder if you'd
start
have to
eating
pay
peaches
him.
And plums.
Yeah. All right, let's take ourselves a little break.
LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
This is Adam Carolla.
This is Dr. Drew. You're listening to 100.5
The Zone.
Welcome back to LoveLine with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
I think it's great. We keep listening.
On 100.5 The Zone.
Back with the best of LoveLine. I'm Adam. That is Dr. Drew. And our next guest is a guy who's, the exterior, he's a tough guy, but the interior is really pussycat.
You know, when I did the Crank Yakkers, he's who I was imitating.
Oh, you were?
The way he talks. Yeah, in my head. I know it did sound like him. That's who I was trying to sound like.
Yeah. There's a good part. I don't know if it's in the show or not, but holds the mic up to his chest, and you can hear his mechanical titanium valve flapping up and down.
Yeah, Everlast.
Yeah, you know what that is? Yeah, that's Everlast. Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla.
That's a hit, dude.
It's Dr. Drew.
Know, a new sitcom was invented during that break.
Yes.
Yeah, scrambled eggs. The egg is donated, and 15, 16 years later, the kid shows up at the doorstep.
That's it.
Wants some of the money. That's the first request.
Yeah.
Want some of the $3,500
sure,
bucks?
Sure, it is.
Yeah, and then hijinks ensue after this.
Oh, yeah.
Everlast is here, and...
That's the intro every week, is that going down.
The showing up at the door.
Yeah, yeah. No, the donating and buying of the shopping spree.
After the egg donation.
Like the Mary Tyler Moore show in the beginning when she's running around the streets and, you know, the pigeons are flying, you know, she's on a shopping spree on Rodeo.
And you know, it is kind of weird. I mean, this is the real sort of scary societal part is not only are your eggs for sale, but there is a price depending on how tall you are, how blue your eyes are. What your education is.
This is what people are concerned about.
I mean, it's just a few steps earlier than selling your actual child. I mean, in a weird sort of way.
Well, let's go a little, stretch it even further and go, we took great exception to what the post-Weimar Germany was up to.
You right. Yeah, the whole Aryan thing.
That's right. And here we are.
Well, you know what it is? You know what the other...
You know, they won't... I mean, another thing is, like, people get all up in arms about a thing like, you know, stem cell research on, you know... children that aren't born or whatever, you know, stillborn, whatever, dead children. But nobody freaks out about somebody just slanging their eggs on the internet. You know what I'm saying?
Scrambled eggs, baby.
Scrambled eggs, man. I think we're going to be rich.
Wait, aren't you rich already?
You're rich, too.
All right. Well, I'm saying we're already rich.
I don't
rich,
get invited to the party place, but I've seen it.
We're gonna
I've been
be,
on the block. Man.
We're
going to
be richer.
Would you visit Everlast? Or be real there?
Yes, back in the day, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, he had to move out of the neighborhood. We got together. He's a great kid.
There's a
we
rapper
didn't want
on
that
the
element
street.
There.
Yeah, rapper.
I hear he's Chicano.
His real name is Louie.
Louie, and you know his last name is one of those ends with the Alez or the Zez or the something. You know what I'm saying?
Alice.
Yeah, he's got one of them crazy Mexican names.
No.
Straight name?
Straight
Schwartz.
No.
Jew. Either way, it's out.
Oh, you're wrong. You're getting letters behind that one.
Oh, please.
I'm telling you.
They know. Mexicans are Jews. No,
they got a strong lobby.
Robert?
Yes.
Oh, good. All right.
Hi, my name is Robert, and I was wondering what pericarditis was.
It's inflammation of the sac that lines your heart. Your heart sits in sort of a sac. It's called a pericardium. And
really?
And it can get infected. Yeah.
Never hear about that.
Yeah. If you virus, your age, it'd probably be a virus, but you can get tuberculosis. You get all kinds of things in there.
So it's where are the long-term effects by it, you know?
Usually nothing from a viral pericarditis. Usually it's fine.
Everlast, how's your valve doing?
Lovely.
Can we hear it?
Sure. Here, let's get down.
What's that?
Wait, let's hold on. Hear that
me?
Clicking?
Hello?
Hold
right,
on.
Hold on a second. I have to put everyone on hold because it'll screw everything
right, listen.
Up.
I'm giving
listen,
you a show. Nobody
listen.
Gets hairs. That's dope.
That's the valve, right?
That's a Bjork Shiley, or what do you got in there?
St. Jude's?
St. Jude's valve.
St.
Right?
Jude's valve, yes.
And is that, what is that, a mechanical
valve? Yeah,
titanium.
Titanium, but it's not. It doesn't have a power source.
No. There's the blood moving in and out, makes it go up and down.
Wow.
Yeah.
You ought to sample that.
Yeah.
Put that on your next.
Recorded. It's on every vocal track, you know, that I do. Like, because it's really, it's faint right here, but like when you're in just a tight booth that's this small and it's on the
mic,
you hear it.
You do?
Oh, yeah. You sit around with me like in just watching TV. If it's in the right acoustics of the room, it's like, what the heck is that?
I've
had many people be like, What's your watch? And I'm like, it's not my watch. It's me. You know,
it's a ticker, but it's not.
Wow. And how's the longevity of that valve? Is it
great.
Good?
Oh, yeah.
Don't have to monkey.
When I woke up, I was terrified they had put a pig valve in my heart. But they said they only do that to really older people because it only lasts like 10 years.
Yeah.
But I think it had more to do that with it was Cedar Sinai and their culture over there. I don't think
right.
It was with the pig valve.
Well, why? But why would they not put the titanium in an older person?
I can't give you an answer to that.
Is it more expensive?
No. You know, you're on Coumadin?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. You don't have to be anticoagulated when you're on Coumadin.
Yeah, it can't be.
Let me tell you something
about
luck.
Yeah.
And living just in that the closest hospital to my house was Cedar Sinai and how much that had to do with the fact that I'm still alive today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like one of the best heart surgeons in the world was there.
I mean, when you had... Well, did you have? Was it a heart attack?
It was called an upper ascending aortic aneurysm.
Why
is what happened
transecting,
to me?
Or a dissecting aortic aneurysm.
Okay.
So, and if he was living in Nebraska and out on some farm somewhere,
I'd be dead.
Yeah,
because they needed to get you under the knife now.
And that my doctor, my actual everyday doctor, was affiliated with Cedars. He was like on the board. He did his own practice, but he was like over there. So my records were available. Because I came in the door, and no joke, they found out I was in a band and I'm having a heart attack. They're like, this dude's probably coked out of his mind.
Yeah. Right.
Started treating me in that way. And then came up to me like 10 minutes later, 15 minutes later with papers like, yo, we just found out what's really wrong with you. We've seen your records and we know you were born with this, you know, bicuspid aortic valve and it's torn. And, you know, we got to go in and operate on you like right now.
And they just did it right then.
And like I said, luckily one of the best heart surgeons in the world was there. The kind of guy who like looked at what happened to me was pretty rare.
Wow.
And this guy looked at this like one of them things like, oh, I got to do this. He like really had that kind of attitude like, oh, this is something that don't come along every day.
So they did the whole thing right then and there and there was no follow-up surgery or anything?
No.
See, that in a way, that's kind of the way to do it because in a way, like, you don't want to get rushed in and then have someone say, after we stabilize you and talk to your family and stuff, in about 6 weeks, we're going to undergo an experimental.
I always tell people, like, because my mother had, like, 2 years later, had to have a triple bypass, and, like, she had to wait, like, 2 months to have it, and I always say, I never would have made it.
Yeah, that's the torture.
I would have skipped the country. I would have been like, I'm gone, you know?
Wow. All right. Robert.
Yes.
You're 40? Oh, 48. What's up?
Well, but the 1985-86, I had the doctor thought I had cancer in my left testicle, and they removed it, but it was benign.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm kind of separated, and I'm getting back into the dating scene, and I'm thinking about going back to the doctor. He offered at the time that they took it out to put a prosthetic in.
Yeah.
And I just want to know what are the complications and any side effects.
Why did you say no then?
Well, I was married. I mean, you know, I had one partner. It didn't matter.
And why is it an issue now?
For me, the
very meaning of the word cosmetic is such that it almost can't apply to testicle. The cosmetic testicle; those two words don't go together.
If a girl's going, you know, going down on you with her hand and trying to, you know, feel around, and you know, you feel kind of shy. You know, you don't want the issue to come up. Well,
right.
Why do you only have one? What's up with this?
I had cancer. I had a tumor. They removed it. What's the big deal?
I could feel
this guy where he's coming from.
He's
saving himself. He doesn't want to have to break it down every time. I had this whole ordeal that, you know, I had to live through in my life.
He's not 18, though. He's 48.
Yeah, but let me explain.
He might be a little I'm 33, and I can hear exactly where he's coming from. If I was waiting, like, oh, I dread the moment. She's going to see I got one ball. Oh, God.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it would be an uncomfortable thing.
What if he had no balls? She'd be like, whoa, good times.
No. Good times. Here's what happens. Here's how it works. You're getting intimate. You meet this new chick. You finally feel like you're closing the deal. She's feeling around. All of a sudden, there stops. Like, what's up? And you're like, I lost a testicle to cancer about 10 years ago. And she's like, I lost a son to cancer, too. And then she breaks down and starts crying. Next thing you know, you guys are sitting up drinking herbal tea in the kitchen. You know, you got nothing. You don't want to shift the focus.
You want to break the stride. But I'd love to hear from some women about this. Women just tolerate testes.
But
guys,
listen,
right?
No. Women do not like. Would you shut up, Drew? You know nothing. Shut Drew's mic. He's driving me nuts today. Women do not like the look of a testy, but they also don't like the look of something that is atypical or missing or grotesque or something like that.
Grotesque testicle.
Well, what I'm saying is the only thing worse than a healthy sack is a sack that's been damaged.
I'm saying it's like this, you know, he's about to get the prize, you know, she's gonna go down there and
he doesn't want to break a stride.
Yeah.
And it's like cancer and the topic is just not a sexy thing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Ahead, Robert, get your prosthesis, no big deal.
How do they put a cold?
Yo.
Are you a bro?
Am I a what?
No.
You're a white dude, are you?
Yeah, I am, dude.
You are?
You seen any videos?
He's 48, dude. He probably don't watch MTV.
All right. But you haven't heard me call him dog yet, have you? He can't be black. I would have worked that in at some point.
Yatch!
Yeah.
I would think that if he was black, he should be called Everlong.
Yeah, so he's Everlast.
Okay.
All right. Hey, Robert, you get that prosthetic.
So what's the verdict? Do I get it?
Yeah, get it. I'm outnumbered 2-1.
Go get it.
So what's no side effects? I mean, you know.
No.
You waited a little while. I imagine it was much, much easier surgically before the scarring and whatnot. So it'll be interesting to see if they can actually pull it off.
Man, but by the way, surgically, my thing is it's all the same. It's just like when you got your car at the shop, when the guy says, well, you know, as long as I got up on the rack, and I got the discs off. You want me to repack the bearings? It's going to be a lot easier now. It's like, just do it. As long as you got the sack open, put the fake one in. Should have done it 10 years ago.
Good
but
time.
I guess they do it out of glass, right, Drew?
Acrylic, glass.
Right. Yeah. Everlast is in our studio tonight. We will take ourselves a quick break.
We have silicone ones now, too.
You know, Anderson yells at me for breaking late at this break every night. Yeah. All right, we'll be right back.
Hello, this is your radio. LoveLine will be right back. LoveLine will be right back.
On 100.5, The Zone. You're listening to LoveLine.
LoveLine.
On 100.5, The Zone.
More for the best of Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. And one of the true nice guys in rock and roll coming up. He is...
He stole and married our Loveline TV booker.
Yeah. We had a booker way back when on Loveline, the TV show. And I don't know where he met her. Maybe he met her on our show.
On our show.
All right. And he married her and made an honest woman out of her. And then gave her herpes. His name is Mark Hoppus. Let's get back to the phones. Mark Hoppus is our guest tonight.
He's hello.
From 2482.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Very popular band out here. I don't know. We're in the Southland. I don't know if you've heard them around the country.
I have a really big dick.
That's yeah.
That's one thing you've heard. You've also, they've gone as far as Bakersfield.
Yeah, we've played extensively through the Bakersfield and through the, what's that valley called at that? Part runs through the center of California?
S Valley.
San Joaquin Valley or
no,
something
San
like that?
San Joaquin, yes. I knew it started with an S.
We just played Bakersfield.
That's right. That's right. They have. Mike?
Yeah. Hey, how are you guys?
Good. You're 29. What's up?
Yeah. You know, I've got issues. I call you at the age 29. I'm looking to hook up and get married to a Catholic girl.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Are you you a Kiwi?
An Aussie.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
Going?
My questions are going to my pecker.
Yeah. That's our last Aussie caller called about 3 years ago.
Oh, geez, mate. No, I'm a world traveler. I travel all over.
Right.
26-year-old virgin. Hook up with her, deeply religious. You know, I've never dated a Catholic girl.
Right.
But, you know, I got together. I thought she was really cool. You know, started promising the moon.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
did you put it in her pouch, mate?
No, I did. I gave her a little down under wonder.
Yeah.
She had been a virgin?
Well, she was a virgin. Then she, we started knocking boots for a little bit there. And then she stopped because she felt bad for her religion and she wasn't married and everything like that.
All righty. Mm-hmm. Now so what?
I go like, that's bad enough, you know, just in the sense that, you know what, I'm with a girl who, you know, has very high values, high morals, and, you
sure.
know, I'm a little different to that, but I don't mind it. But she's also deeply obsessive as well.
Uh-huh.
Well, is this your girlfriend now?
Yeah, this is the girl I'm looking to get engaged and married to. I mean, we looked at rings.
Okay.
And like
what's
that,
she obsessive about?
Right.
Like any woman, anything. If I'm sitting in a restaurant next to her or sitting across from her talking to her, and there's someone in there, say a Latino girl, and I'm not looking, but she sees her walk by. She's like, so you like tan skinned girls?
Right.
What?
Right.
What are you talking about?
Right.
Yeah, and it's always like that. Or
okay, all right. So, Mike, hold on for a second.
There's a reason she was a virgin at 26.
That's what I was going to say.
It was not her religion.
Okay. Right. Right. So, Mike, or as I like to call you, Mick. Because that was the name of the title character from Crocodile Dundee, Mick Dundee.
Yes.
Mick, you got to look into her issues, and it's not just that she was a devout Catholic and very pure and you know, had different sensibilities, so she didn't lose her virginity until she was 26. There was some energy there and some issues there, and possibly some issues surrounding men.
And sexuality.
Sexuality, maybe her dad.
And possibly some heavy issues.
Can I mention something?
Yes.
Yeah, just good thing. This is what disturbs me greatly. If you're getting naked and you're about to get a little sneaky, freaky, have some fun there, she'll put her hand on her crotch, or if you even go near it, she'll spend the next month panicking that she's pregnant.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, that's some trauma there, Mike.
Well, right, that's okay. It, Mike. That's the word. There is some trauma there.
All right, so, Mike, here's the deal. I mean, Mick, here's the deal.
McMike.
Mick Dundee. Do not marry her. Not yet. Explore, work these problems out. I suspect there's going to be more here than meets the eye.
Yeah.
But don't rush. Just don't get married yet. Work these things out. And if you can't work them out, don't get married.
There you go.
Right.
Right.
Robin?
Yeah. Hi, Mark.
Hi.
Oh, my God. Okay, I have been one of your guys' biggest fans since 1993. And I've never been to one concert, and that kills me. And I can't believe I'm talking to you.
Where do you live?
Lindsay, California.
Lindsay? I don't know where that's...
Where is that?
It's by Bakersfield.
Uh-huh. We just played Bakersfield, not too long ago. Hey, did you hear my voice go all screech right there? We just play Bakersfield.
Turn it to Bobby Brady. Hey, you guys got coleslaw out there in Lindsay, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. I may be moving out.
I couldn't go to Bakersfield because I was grounded. So. Wow.
What'd you get grounded for? Hopefully it was something good.
Grades.
We just played Bakersfield.
Go ahead, Robin.
Okay. My question is, you know how you guys would have, like, we get to send mail to Sombrero?
Yes.
Do you guys still do that? Do you, like, go check it every time? Or?
We still do check the mail at Sombrero, Mexican food restaurant.
Mm.
Yeah, because I've sent so many letters, and I don't know if you guys still do it or not. So you do?
Yeah, we do. We get all the mail from there. We go, and they'll hand us, like, a box of mail, and we'll sit there and read it.
And they actually, Sombrero actually uses them to serve up their soft tacos, their fish soft tacos. They actually set it onto the fan.
Mails, yeah. In the plastic baskets, then the mail.
You know, in England, the fish and chips the newspaper?
Of course.
Same thing. Blink 182 fan mail.
Okay.
Just kidding, Robin. Yeah. All right, babe.
Okay, wait, can I ask one more thing?
No. you've asked two things. That's enough. Okay.
Tell him you love him.
Tell me a lot.
I love you.
There you go.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
If she'd laughed at it, just half of one of my jokes, I would have let her ask the third question. Casey?
Yeah?
You're 15?
Yeah.
What's up?
I had a question for Mark.
Yeah.
Where I lived, I've heard some like, remarks about Blink. I mean, my first question for you is, like, your music, what do you guys, like, really consider that? Do you consider it punk or...
I don't know. I mean, we write music. Whatever, for categories is for other people to figure out. We write music that we enjoy and that means something to us. And as far as categories go, that's not something that really concerns us.
Yeah. Okay. Because I've heard some people, you know, say they like your older albums because it's more a quote punkish or whatever. And, you know, you guys have turned pop, but I mean, I still like everything you guys do.
See, that's weird to me because I think our older stuff is way popular than our newer stuff. I mean, if you listen to stuff off of Cheshire Cat, like, you know, I mean, Wasting Time and M&M's is really pretty, I mean, it's pretty sing-along-y kind of stuff. I thought we got harder as we went along, but, you know, we just write music and...
But don't you think that people sort of base that on sales?
Success.
Like, if one album sells 200,000, it's like, yeah, that was really raw, that was really punk, and you're edgy. And then if you sell 10 million records of an album that may be punkier, they're going to go, right, that's more mainstream, more pop.
Yeah, definitely.
All right. Hey, Casey?
Yeah?
You're 15, baby.
Yeah.
Why don't you start sounding like you're 15?
This is Santa Cruz, Adam.
You've been smoking a lot of weed?
Oh, yeah.
No, I don't smoke any weed.
What, are you depressed?
No.
What's the matter with you?
Nothing, just family issues, I guess.
All right. That's called depression, though.
Sound like an old soul at 15.
Yeah.
That makes you depressed, all that family stuff.
Yeah, when I was 15, I had a wind-up beanie on my head and a bottle of Jergens in the other hand. I was
be realistic here. Well, either you or I would have sounded exactly like Casey at 15.
No, I wouldn't.
And 17 and 19.
I wouldn't sound like Uncle Charlie from My Three Sons. Like,
I guess I just have, people have told me I just have a deeper voice over the phone.
Okay, brother. But look, enjoy your life, would you?
No.
You're 15. On. It keeps getting worse.
Yeah.
Just enjoy yourself now.
Yeah. It was Uncle Joe from Petticoat Junction.
Okay, there, buddy.
All right. See you guys later.
Yeah. Right.
See ya.
Good time. Uncle Joe, he's moving kind of slow at the junction.
What are you going to do?
You know what? This show is really...
it's a review of really 70s television.
Drew and I talking about shows that were on 20 years before anyone who listens to our show was born. Ridiculous. Samantha? Samantha?
Threesome!
Oh. No.
There you are. Hi.
All right. Your boyfriend wants a threesome.
Yeah.
Has he picked out the girl?
No. I don't think so.
How is he going to recruit this girl?
I think it's one of his friends, he said.
Uh-oh. Well... Does he know which one?
No.
He
has, like, a lot of girlfriends that I don't know.
What's up with that? Yeah. Doesn't that trouble you a little bit?
Huh?
Doesn't that trouble you a little bit that he's hanging out with a bunch of girls?
Yeah.
Hmm. How long have you been with this guy? Turn your radio off.
Yeah, listen.
Again with that.
Oh, who cares? I'm not asking questions twice and dealing with the incoherent on this show. I'm done with the, huh? What? Just forget it. you call this show, our phone screeners tell you to turn the goddamn radio down. You refuse to do it, so you sit on hold, and then I hang up.
All right, bottom line, this guy sounds like an a-hole. Not interested in Samantha. And Adam has a way of abusing victims, so she must have been a victim.
What's up?
Jay?
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, you hear yourself again there in the background?
Yeah, Jay. If you keep listening, you're going to hear the part about me calling you guys a-holes for not turning your radio down.
Okay.
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've got a problem.
Hold on. Are you ready? He's the one that has to turn his radio down. We're waiting for him to turn his radio down. He wants to know if we're ready for him. How dare you? Rick?
Yeah.
You're 32.
I am.
What's up?
I got a couple questions for Mark and one for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
Mark,
yes.
You guys hear it all the time, but you guys rock.
Thank you.
If there's ever been a funnier video than all the small things, I'd really like to see it.
Thanks a lot.
Two questions for you.
All right.
How did you guys meet?
Tom and I met because my sister was dating one of Tom's best friends, and so she introduced us.
Okay.
Yep.
Did you live in the same vicinity?
How did you come up with the name for the band?
Well, I live with my dad in a small town called Ridgecrest, and my sisters live with my mom in San Diego. I graduated from high school in Ridgecrest and moved to San Diego to go to college, and so that's how I met Tom, when I moved to San Diego to go to college. So the day after I moved to San Diego, I went to Tom's house and met him and started playing songs in his garage.
Wow.
And the name, to answer your second question, Tom made up, just Blink. He thought it would be a cool one-word action verb. He wanted to be named after a verb, and so Blink was the one that we chose. And then there was another band from Ireland called Blink, and so we chose 182 to differentiate ourselves.
I see.
Why the numbers?
Okay.
The numbers, I wish there was a rad story, but it's totally random. What happened was we had to change our name. The label called us up and said, you need to pick a new name. We said, all right, we'll call you back. And we never called them back. And 2 weeks later, they called us up again and said, what's your new name? We said, oh, we haven't decided. We'll call you back later on this afternoon. And it kept going that way for about a month. Finally, they called us up and said, if you don't choose a name on this phone call, we're picking a new name for you. And so we said, all right, how about Blink 182? And that's...
Really? Whose brain did that come out of?
I think mine.
Wow, that's just completely random.
Yeah.
That there's three numbers there.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Were you looking at something?
No. In fact, I remember there was a point where we were going, what sounds better? 182, 170, 4... And so there was about 3 minutes of that. We just said 182.
Wow, interesting. Okay. And now Ridgecrest is up there in the Mojave Desert.
It's out. Yeah, it's out there.
Oh my God.
That's where I grew up.
Adam. Oh my God. This trumps Phoenix.
Oh, trumps Phoenix.
Yeah, this is like the Mojave. No, this is.
It's really, it's not hotter than Phoenix though.
When it is, it is not all year round like that. It's the road to Mammoth.
Yeah, it's.
No. Yeah. Yeah.
We had one stoplight when I was growing up in this town. One. And then when they had the second stoplight, they had like a parade and the mayor came out and cut the tape.
It's in front of the Inyokern courthouse.
Oh, true. What do you know?
I had a speeding ticket up there once. I had to drive back. They made you drive back to Ridgecrest to
that here. That in itself should be like your sentence.
That's
you
your
know?
Sentence.
Just
yeah.
Showing up.
Yes.
Go, okay.
You paid your debt to society. Yeah. You came back to this stinking town for a second time.
Oh.
Yes.
21 years of my life spent in that place.
Oh. I mean, it is a tumbleweed town. There's stuff blowing down the streets. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, because you see it on the way in. I mean, when you're going, do you see it on the way into Yosemite?
If you take that route, but it's off in the distance. It's like I'm by the road, right?
Yeah.
What was your dad doing? Like running moonshine?
No, he designs missiles and bombs for the military.
Oh, that's right.
He's very excited right now. He called me the other day because it's the national celebration of the, I think it's the, 20th or 50th anniversary of the Sidewinder missile, something like that. So he's got
very exciting.
Yeah.
Che?
Was that your question, what my dad does for his living?
No, Rick.
Jay got angry with you, Adam. And hung up.
Jay, did you hang up?
No, I'm still here.
Oh, there he is.
All right, what's up?
I've got a problem with my girlfriend.
All right.
I've been with her for 1 year, like Saturday. And at first, her parents were cool with us being together. She's underage. And at first, her parents were cool with us being together, but now they're not.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way these things turn into legal actions.
Yeah.
That's the way
I'm trying to break it off with her.
How old is she?
She's 14.
Oh. You're 19, huh?
Yes, sir.
Hold on a second. Let's see, my impulse is Jay was a jackass when I first tried to speak to him the first couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. All see right. if he's on probation for anything.
You on probation for anything?
Am I?
Yes.
No.
Okay. Well, you soon will be. And are you having sex with her?
Yes.
Oh. You are such a you lovely individual.
You shouldn't even be saying that on the radio, frankly.
Well, maybe I shouldn't be asking. Mm. Okay. We appreciate your candor, Jay. You can look up candor after we're done with the call. But now, listen. You want to break up with her because you think her parents are going to come down on you now. And say, they've threatened you. They threatened to send
no,
you to
they're
jail.
Not, they're not threatening at all. You know what I'm saying? They're not threatening at all.
They're not?
No, they don't even know we're together now.
Well,
they thought we broke up a while ago.
Well, right. why do you call and say that her parents are not down with you two?
They weren't cool with it, which is why we made them think we broke up.
Well, but you did say initially they were cool with you.
Yeah, they told me to move in with them.
What switched things around?
Me and she ran away from home, and I was staying with one of my friends at the time. I didn't know what to do with her. So I took her to my older sister.
Yeah.
And to ask my sister's advice, and my sister's like, all right, come on, I'll take you home. And she did that, and my girlfriend's dad got up in my sister's face and started cussing at her. And later that day, we saw him, and he...
Wherever he's from, I didn't want to fly over it. I'd be scared at like 40,000 feet. Jay just used the S word, so I put him on hold.
All right, so, you know, no doubt the girl's dad's an a-hole, okay, too, right?
Listen,
and why else would she go for Jay?
Look, okay, listen.
And he's
Jay,
abusive, that
listen
question
to me,
right from
listen
home.
To me. What do you want to do? You want to end up on a Springer show or something?
No, I'm trying to break it off with
okay,
her.
That's it.
Tonight I tried to do that, and she started crying.
Well, listen, she's 14. Her grown-up teeth are probably coming in. That's why she's crying.
She believes she's going to marry
you.
She's
losing her baby teeth, or she's sat on her retainer or something.
She believes she's going to marry you. That's in her mind.
Okay.
And so the breakup thing is out of the blue for her. She can't maybe fathom that. But that's, of course, where these relationships
by the way, when's she going to be 15?
June 8th of next year.
All right. So you've been dating her since she was 13?
Yeah, and I was.
Oh my
God! I had just turned 18.
Okay, listen, screwball. What are you doing? You can't date kids.
At first, I didn't know how old she was,
she's eighth grader, Jay.
We just stayed together.
Hey, Jay, eighth grader.
All right, well, as long as you didn't know the first time you met her how old she was, and then decided to stay with her after you found out she was 13, you're making quite an argument for yourself, Jay.
I had already kind of fallen in love with her.
No. Jay, listen, what's up, brother? You're 19 years old. Come on. You're supposed to be looking for a job at this point in life. What are you doing, working some form of construction?
No, I was in construction for a little bit. But,
yeah, shocking.
Couldn't maintain.
What are you doing now?
I'm a waiter at a restaurant.
Oh, really? But at IHOP or Arby's, like one of those ones where it's not really a waiter, but you bring the syrup. Kind of things like you bring part of the stuff, but not the whole meal. Yeah, right?
No, not really.
All right. You got coleslaw where you work?
Oh, yeah.
You have an ice cream stand?
Do what?
You have an ice cream stand?
Yeah, because Mark's going to do whippets while I eat the coleslaw.
All right. Sounds good.
All right, listen. You break up with her, and from now on, you date old chicks like us,
that's
like 18.
That's what I'm trying to ask your advice on. How am I supposed to go about breaking up with
you? Just do it. You just do it over the phone, and she's kind of like, I want to meet, I want to exchange this, I want to talk to you, I got to see your face.
Contact.
Do
stop
the gentlemanly
contact.
Thing and just stop calling her.
Give her a break, no contact.
No contact. Ugh.
There's no way to let it any of the
Jay's an idiot. Jay's going to get into another scrap with Dad, and she's a mess, and he's 13. And
oh, my God.
Meets her when she's 13. Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God.
What the hell? But first off, you can barely talk to adult women. Imagine 13. You know, I don't got much to say to 35-year-old women. I can't imagine 13.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Take a little break. Mark here from Blink 182.
Thank you.
Take a break. Right back.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline.
Hello there, Loveline fans. This is Adam Carolla.
This is Dr. Drew. Stick around for more right here on 100.5 The Zone.
Our next guest is higher than Snoop Dogg and marginally funnier than Margaret Cho. It's Jim Brewer. Yeah, trap. Drive job.
That's where are them juggies? Yeah, you got them with you?
How many times have we asked that?
Where are the juggies? They're all getting. What time is it? I'm at 4 o'clock. I'm hoping they're asleep. They could be hopped up on coke with some Arab guys, but they probably passed out by now.
Yeah. What's the Arab guys?
What is that? Arab guy? Oh, yeah. Jim Brewer is our guest tonight. Jim's got himself a comedy CD out called Smoke and Brew. And Jim, what, 4 years on SNL?
Yes.
Let's see.
Actually, it was like three. It was three.
Three.
It was 95, 98. It was part of the new cast.
Who was who came in when you came in?
Sherry O'Terry, Molly Shannon, Mark McKinney, Will Ferrell.
This guy's all. That was all your class, as it
were. We were the new class,
and
we were the 95 class. Norm MacDonald was like the veteran.
How'd you get along with Norm?
Norm was my favorite cast member. Yeah. He was the only guy. This is when I knew Norm was the only guy. You know when you get a job, and like they give you the big speech.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we expect this from you. Then go out there and do it.
And then as soon as you're done, you get the one guy who listens. Well, he said, forget that. Here's how it goes down. Mm-hmm. That was like, Norm was that guy in the cast. He, you know, because Mondays we'd pitch our ideas to a host. I remember I had one season under my belt. You know, I'm starting to buy new clothes, get a car. I got a goat thing. And Tom Hanks.
Got a goat thing.
Yeah. Tom Hanks. I'm flipping out. This is the first real big star on here. And you can tell we were all starstruck. And Sherry O'Terry's like, I'm going to do this cheerleader. She pitches her thing. Everyone's pulling out their big cannons. I'm going to do Mary Catherine Gallagher. I'm going to do the goat. And Nora's like, yeah. Yeah, I'm going to do the guy who poops his pants. You're like the guy, you're like, ah, I got poop in my pants. Yeah, man. That guy. There's a story I can't tell it now. I did on the thing there, and they were in a press conference.
It's on the CD.
Did you see him? Did you see him on Dennis Miller? There.
Wait, what did he say?
Nothing.
On that thing there. Yeah, I'm guessing
on the CD. Yeah,
to the CD. That's you no, see him on not Dennis in this
Miller?
Room.
No. By far, Norm was the funniest guy on the show. He just said it the way it was, and if he didn't like it,
right. Even told Lennon, don't put me in sketches.
Right.
I gotta do update. Don't put me in a little gay sketch in the background.
Yeah,
I like Norm.
I know a little bit, and he's authentically a strange guy. I
mean, he's a strange bird.
It's not an act. I mean, the guy's a gambler.
He tells
problem.
You right up. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. And I've never. I don't know any. I mean, women like him, but I don't know any women that like him. Do you know what I'm
they
saying?
Don't like him.
They're the spite ones.
Yeah, it's not. I don't know. I think he's a misogynist, but he definitely seems to get along with them. I don't think he has.
They
a lot
think
of,
he's hot. Every chick that meets him, like, oh my God, look me up with Norm MacDonald.
Yeah,
I'm like, are you sure? Because don't come to me after I do.
No, yeah. I want to.
Yeah, he's great.
Bro.
Big gambler. I love it when he does the younger Burt Reynolds, the smoking the bandit Burt Reynolds. You ever see that?
Yep.
He just sits there with a bad fake mustache.
Yeah, where's that up, Jeff?
Yeah. He dresses in the smoking the bandit outfit, and he just sort of stands there, and he does that chewing motion, you know? Yeah, yeah, yeah. He doesn't really say anything. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why. Who decided to do that?
He did.
17 years after smoking the bandit,
he did.
Was
That's why he's genius, man.
I don't know where he is though.
He used
where
to come out. He used to. I don't know. He used to come out and warm up the shows.
Oh, really?
At Saturday Night Live, and he'd go. I would go up and try to kill. I'd try to blow the place out the water. Give it my A material for 10 minutes.
Would you pull the goat boy out?
So I'd pull the goat. All the big guns are coming out. Norm would come out and he'd go. Yeah, I'm working on a new impression. And he'd go, here's, Johnny Carson, bringing out a famous act. Okay, anyway. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to bring out, I'm a big famous guy. I need some work on that.
That'd be so bad.
Yeah,
he just did
Norm.
Care. I like him.
I gotta get Norm back on to something. Amy? Or maybe off of something. Amy, you're 22, but hold on a second. I was reading the screen.
At least he doesn't hide it.
No, he's got problems. Jordan?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Yep.
You had sex for the first time?
Yeah.
When?
I had sex about a couple of weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
I believe him.
Yeah.
See?
And you lasted for 1 minute?
Yep.
I believe that, too.
I don't know if it's pleasing for the girl or not, you know?
Don't worry about it. Not at this stage. Nothing you do first time out is going to be particularly pleasing for her.
Was it her first?
No, it wasn't her first.
Right.
It was like her second or third.
Still, she got a ways to go before it becomes actually pleasant.
But is that normal, though? Or?
Well, that's good. Yeah, first time out, most guys are rather rapid or have trouble getting an erection. That's real.
There's always some trouble that runs the spectrum of too long or too quick or not at all. But
yeah. There's
always something.
It's scary.
Go ahead and get a relationship going with her, and things will work themselves out.
Yeah. Is she your girlfriend, Jordan?
Yeah, she's my girlfriend.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, is it okay for her to get angry at me? Should I just let that go? Or?
Did she get angry at you?
No, she just like, well, kind of, you know, because she didn't get any pleasure out of it.
Well, what about oral sex?
No, we haven't tried that yet.
All right.
What do you mean she got angry?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird.
What do you mean, Jordan?
Well, I mean, she didn't get angry, but she just, you know, she wasn't very pleased about it, you know.
What'd she say?
She's like, well, you know, I didn't get any pleasure out of this, you know, I don't know if we should do this again.
Okay, now it's a bogus call.
Yeah, sorry, Jordan.
That's BS.
And who's your buddy with tuberculosis who's breathing in the background?
Oh, that's me.
Oh, okay.
I'm a huge fan of the show. I've been listening since sixth grade.
Thanks, buddy.
He's all bitter. Right,
listen, buddy, you gotta get an inhaler before you get on the other line.
All right. I love your show, man.
Thanks, buddy. Listen, you jackoffs. If you're going to call the show and have your buddy on the second line, don't have him making love to the receiver.
Swallowing it.
He's just hanging out.
That's what he says. It's really him. It's really them, man.
And what's the guy doing? Beating arm? Like,
he's just very excited hearing your voice.
He's excited,
Adam.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, but now I don't know if they don't make phones this way anymore. But back in the day, we should just unscrew the receiver,
or you'd put a handkerchief over the. Remember that old trip?
Yeah, but you'd put your hand on it. You'd listen. You don't need. See, like, remember the old school phones? You could physically unscrew thing and pop that thing
still
out.
Had a wire too. Oh, yeah.
Sure. Yeah, it was good. Yeah. So I don't believe that kid, right?
No, ridiculous. I believe he's a virgin. Not a virgin, though. I got not a virgin from his voice.
I don't know, Drew. He may be a virgin.
You can tell right in the voice.
He may be a virgin. And he's, you know, guys who get laid don't make as many prank calls. By the way, that's when the prank calling ends for guys.
That's why all you and all your comedic buddies.
That's why we're still doing all the crazy things. Let me see. Jordan?
Right, yeah.
Are you there? Listen, you're a virgin, yes?
No.
Seriously.
No, I'm not.
He's a one-timer.
Yeah, one-timer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
all right. It's see, we can tell the sound of a guy's voice who's a virgin and a guy who's getting laid a lot, but the one-time guys, it's
between,
hard because it's the crossover voice. All right, let's talk to
still cracks. Amy.
And by the way, we know it's a bogus call because no woman says, "I'm angry.
I'm angry and I'm not satisfied, so we shouldn't do this anymore."
Right.
What was that?
No, they think that after every lovemaking session, but they don't verbalize it.
Then on. That's right.
Amy?
Yes.
You're 22?
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Well, I don't know necessarily where to start. I've been in a relationship, committed relationship, for about 2 years. And we decided to have some fun. And we brought, a girl I was attracted to into the relationship and had her a couple times. And then her boyfriend wanted to join us. So we had him in the relationship.
Wow.
And, of course, we had unprotected sex. And about 10 days ago, I had a nice, wonderful sore in the area between my anus and my vagina.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided to go to the doctor because I have regular physicals. In May, I had a full STD check. And I tested positive for herpes.
What do you mean you tested positive? What tests did they give you?
Well, what they did is they more or less scraped the cells.
Okay, all right.
She opened up and looked on my cervix.
All right, that's how you do it. Okay.
But ultimately, I started the medicine. I'm on Valtrex now, mm-hmm. and I just need to know how to approach this couple that we've been with. I mean, I don't want to point fingers, and I don't want to, because the blame's on myself for more or less having unprotected sex with mm-hmm. them. But, I mean, I need to know more or less how to approach them and how I should handle my sex life in the future.
Well, as far as, I think you have a sort of ethical obligation, and it'd be, from a medical standpoint, definitely important that they know that they have this thing.
You think they don't know?
Well, if they sometimes women don't know. Some women carry and don't know. But point is, your obligation.
Would you get it? Would you get it from the woman or from the guy, though?
Well, that's what I want to kind of know too. Is I mean, the clinician, I guess is her name. I don't know. The lady I talked to at the clinic said that people carry it and they don't know.
That's right. Women
they have their first outbreak.
It's more no, not their first outbreak. They have outbreaks and sort of miss them.
Okay.
How do you miss that?
Because sometimes they're not that severe, or they're inside the vagina. They're not on the outside.
Yeah, but how does the woman give it to the other woman on her vagina?
Well, it's in the between anusberg and
vaginaville.
Yeah,
but
and maybe it was on somebody's hand. You see what I'm
really?
Saying?
Really?
Wow! Can well, pass through it like that?
What was going on? Did her vagina get near your vagina?
Well, I was fisted. But there, I mean, that could be something also. But
hold on. What happened to you?
I got to laugh and beat off. Hold on.
I didn't think this stuff really happened.
We were together when the four of us were together. Is right after the outbreak occurred. But
oh wait a second! I'm curious what her boyfriend does during the fisting. Like, sweetie, I'm going in the kitchen. You want a tab or any? You want a tab? How about I know you got. I only got the one hand used up, but Bob, you want a Michelob or something?
You hear him in the other room. What are you swinging at?
You need a towel.
That's a high pitch, stupid.
He's watching Sports Center, drinking a beer. I was fisted. Let me ask about the fisting. It's something that seems to be thrown about quite casually, but are people making a fist? And
then.
They go in and make the fist, but...
But it's done with the... What would this be called?
Well, it's
the fist. Snake. Yeah. Snake
it's fisting. It's like when you're trying to get that last pickle out of the jar. You don't make the fist and ram it in. You slide
it's
in. And then
get something out of the garbage disposal.
Right. Yeah. Oh, true.
No, that's what it
what
is.
What kind of euphemism but is I mean, that for a woman's
euphemism.
Vagina?
It's just how the hand is
garbage
configured.
Disposal. I've never heard it referred to as a garbage disposal. Yeah. Wait till I tell your wife what you called her.
You haven't seen Amy, right?
Oh... Oh, wait a minute. Yeah. Hey, Amy.
Yeah, I'm glad you guys have humor over this.
Well, you know, that's the way we deal with tragedy.
It's all good.
Right. Now, let me just ask, and we'll answer your question, but the fisting part.
Mm-hmm.
No fist on the way in, right?
Well, it's like, I mean, I'm wet and I'm moist and it's, I mean, I like the pressure. In fact, I'm actually scared that when I have children, I'll orgasm from it because I like the pressure that's there when...
Now, if you orgasm, does the kid just go shooting out like
well,
you're launching
children,
a water balloon
know.
From one of those? No, okay. And the fisting part, but here's my question about the fisting because I'm unclear. Is the fist made before it enters the vagina or is it let in sort of like your hand is in a sock puppet and then made into a fist?
Well, it depends upon the size of the hand.
I see. In this case...
In this case, what happened?
The fingers were inserted in a cup shape type.
Right. Yeah. And then the fist is made?
It's more or less just continually pressed in until I can't handle the pressure anymore, and then I tell them to get out.
All right. So it's not really a fisting, is it? But it's
arming,
a full it's
handing.
A full handing, right?
Sure, we could call it fingering, but it's, I mean, usually to the wrist.
Okay.
To the wrist.
Wristing,
yeah.
Okay.
And where's... Now, who was doing this to you?
Actually, two people at various different times. One, the female, and the other, my...
She's getting stuffed all over.
First, the female, and then your guy went in when she lost her watch?
Well, because they wanted to
see
her hand would fit further than the guy's, because the guy, he's got larger hands.
I see.
And her hands were smaller, so they wanted to see.
And was the guy...
What's the guy doing while she's fisting?
They're usually sitting on the side, touching themselves, jacking off, whatever. I mean, it's an awe and amazement of what's being done.
Hold on, Jim. What kind of retarded question? What's the guy doing?
Was
of course he's feeding off.
Well, I didn't know if he was trying to stuff somewhere else. You know, I'm trying to feel her out where she's going.
Now, this was the girl and your
fist
man
the
or
mouth?
The girl and her man?
It was actually all of us, but the hands that were inside of me was my man and her.
Because you're traditional that way?
Well, I prefer anything and everything, but that's what gets me into this situation.
Oh, wow. Well, now, Amy,
yes.
This is interesting to me.
Okay.
Let me see if I can get a physical description of you.
38 double D.
Oh.
I have about 34 waist. I mean, that my jeans are men's 34s.
You're fat.
Drew, please. Let's
get that. Yeah, I'm very voluptuous. I have an hourglass figure. I got a big-ass booty. And, yeah, if you want to call it fat, that's great. But
All right.
I get what I want.
You get what you want. Now, that's the beauty of being well. Now, how tall do you go?
I'm 5'7".
5'7". What do you weigh in at?
Too much.
Too much? 200? 250?
About 180.
About 180. Let me do some quick math.
Do your math, yes. And I know what venison is, and I know what veal is.
Hold on, baby.
Thank you.
5'7", 180. Come with 5.
Bitch!
I got 5'5", and 3/16", 197.
Oh, thank you.
All right. Not bad. You didn't crack the 200.
Not too bad.
Oh, baby. What happened to you growing up? Anything bad?
No, I had a pretty normal life besides the fact that my parents got divorced, but that happens with everyone.
No no fisting in your youth?
No, I was never sexually abused. I was always intrigued by sex, though. I mean, I read form from my parents. And
what? So they had a bunch of pornography lying around when you were a kid?
Well,
no, I mean, I would actually, like, hunt for it, but that was just because I was intrigued by it.
How old were you when
probably about 8, 9.
Did you walk in your parents or anything, doing anything ever?
I mean, I could hear them. They had a waterbed.
Okay.
But otherwise.
Waterbed. Yeah. That's therapy right there.
Just parents with a waterbed.
Folks have a waterbed. You got to go. That's at least five years therapy.
5 years minimum. Absolutely.
Yeah, if it was heated, you're up to 7 years.
Okay,
all right, but wait, Amy, I'm not done. Now, what does your man do? Anything?
He's actually a firefighter.
Ooh, interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. And this couple, so friends, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, we play darts with them.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, sure. Why not play a parlor game after you're done fisting your friend? It's nice. Hey, who's up for darts? Well, I'm not done fisting your wife, Chet. Okay, well, I'm gonna start warming up. You all right?
Let's have some pork chops, some beer, and fist your wife. Who's in?
let's flip it over and play the baseball side of the dartboard this time. Let's live. Does anyone ever do that, by the way? Has anyone ever in the human history played the baseball game on the back of the dartboard?
No,
so, Amy.
Yeah,
it seems to me that you have an open relationship with these people. I mean, you're someone who doesn't mind speaking your mind.
You've got to just let them, just put them on notice. Whether you want to send them a letter or whatever, they probably knew about it. They probably exposed you to it. There's no doubt that she worry about sexual relationships in the future. Just be honest with people. Make sure they wear a condom. Make sure you're not having an outbreak, and they should be reasonably protected.
All right, let's take ourselves a little break.
Loveline,
1-800-LOVE-191.
Back in a minute.
This is Adam Carolla.
And this is Dr. Drew.
And I couldn't be happier.
Fantastic. 100.5.
The Zone.
Welcome back to Loveline with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla on 100.5 The Zone.
Love your station. I totally got hooked and I don't listen to anything else.
Everybody, best of Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Our next guest is a world champion surfer who's, I'd say, the biggest name in surfing.
I finally saw that Blue Crush thing.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I saw it on a plane a couple days ago.
Was he in there?
No.
No.
But I just, you know, made me think of him.
Smooth segue, Drew. Enough? How many years of radio you got on your belt? 30 years?
Is this thing on?
Yeah, you don't know the name of it, do you? All right, next up, Kelly Slater. 191. Kelly Slater is our guest tonight. Kelly is a 6-time world champion surfer. All right.
How'd you guys get mashed up?
Drew did this job for
10 years
before I got here. I showed up at K-Rock, the mother station out here in Los Angeles, and the station that this show began on before it was syndicated. I was doing a little work on the morning show. And somebody decided, partly Drew, but not
partly
all
me.
Drew.
It was 100% me. I can tell you where I was standing and who I called and what happened.
That had to do with the TV show. But,
yeah.
But the radio was sort of around before the TV, or at least was discussed before the TV.
Not with me.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't...
It took me a little while to grow into the TV show, because I was so used to listening to you guys on the radio. Mm. And then when I saw the TV show, it didn't move as quickly or something.
Yeah, it was never quite right. It was sort of okay for TV, but if you knew the radio show, you should like the radio show more than TV. And in general, that's a good time for me to bring this up. You folks out there, you should be listening to more radio, more talk radio. It's interesting.
It's all I listen to.
It's stimulating. There's a lot of good, talented people out there. You don't have to listen to us. You can listen to other people. It's a good thing to do.
I was thinking
It'll make you smarter.
Yeah, I was thinking about the same thing today. I was thinking about our television show and about how so much of it was a visual thing and the content almost didn't matter to people. And radio, the content's everything.
Yeah.
What you say is the whole deal.
No, it's
TV's visual content. Yeah. I mean, you guys should have just hired a whole bunch of the like hottest girls you could with really radical problems.
We did some of that.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know the thing that
they called it the Man Show though.
Oh, how dare you.
That's right.
That's a modern classic.
But you ironically poke fun of at your problems and it's all good.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah. The Man Show, the guys end up getting the short end of the stick in that show anyway, if you really think about it. All right, let's move forward here and take a call for Kelly. Alex?
Yeah.
You're 16?
Right. Kelly, I was wondering, how come you threw the contest at Lowers today?
You threw it. I just didn't feel like winning 30 grand in a car, that's all.
Didn't feel like... Well, also, you've been lagging on the ASP pretty... I mean, you come back, you're tired, right? After winning, and you come back and you're just doing horrible. What's the deal? How come you're just not in the mood to win this year?
should I hit you with the emotional side of it or?
Go.
You are an asshole.
All right, there you go. Well, you know, if I got to get serious about it, my father passed away right after the first event.
That was how long ago?
That was in April.
And did that affect your serving?
I
would assume
it just
would.
Made me. Well, you know, it was a really growing time for me. It was actually a beautiful time spent with my dad right before he passed away. But
you mean like at the hospital and stuff?
At home, we had him at home, and it was a really horrible thing. He had cancer, and anyways, but that was a terrible thing. But we became really close, and then it sort of gave me a feeling like, you know, obviously there's defining moments in your life. Like Dr. Drew's when he knew exactly where he was and who he called, and we were just talking about that.
Oh, really?
Well, when you guys were talking about the radio.
Oh, right. Oh, yeah. He was jogging.
It was a defining moment.
Yeah.
But it just sidetracked me into thinking, you know, there's so many other things in life that are more important, and so my focus just went elsewhere. But,
Well, hold on a second. Let me yell at that, Alex.
No, it's cool.
Hey, Alex.
Yeah.
You little jackass.
Thank you.
You'll never be one-tenth of what Kelly Slater is. You understand me?
Yeah.
One-tenth on your best day.
I respect your opinion.
Though. All right.
You got another question, weirdo?
Bring it up.
Hurry up.
But,
get out of my face right now. Push.
That's good. But other than that, I just didn't have a whole lot of motivation coming back. I had a lot of great years, and I was all about trying to win competitions, and that was my whole life. And now my life is kind of, you know, there's other things going on and other things I'm interested in.
Well, how do you, I mean, what's the difference in a competition? How motivated do you need to be? I mean, I guess what I'm saying is here comes the wave. You're a great surfer. What's your approach? Why would it be any different? I mean, you lost the eye of the tiger kind of thing?
No, there's a lot of...
Is it practice? Do you not practice as much?
No, I'm practicing a bunch. There's a lot of subtle things that go into competing at a high level at anything, you know, chess or, you know, cross-country biking or, you know, whatever you're going to do.
So, right.
There's subtle things you have to, you know about what the conditions are doing, what your opponent is, you know, the way he approaches heats and how he's affected by the way you're going to surf or approach the heat or the scores you get and how he's going to come back from that. And
right.
And then, you know, there's also, you got to sort of pace yourself like a long distance runner or something where you don't want to surf your best right away. You want to sort of just beat the guys you're surfing against and sort of save up your reserves for the end. So you,
do you think because you're Kelly Slater and your name that the judges are a little bit tougher or could be tougher on you?
Or the other way around.
Or the other way around?
Well, I'd have to say it has gone both ways, but it's gone in my favor a lot of times, so I never really was one to complain about the judging. But
right. Well, that's good, because I think most people, if you ask them that question, would just automatically answer, it's gone against me, because that's the way you feel when you go through life. You don't remember the times it goes for you. You go, yeah, I deserve it.
Yeah.
Of course, I was the best man that day.
Well, you know, if you go out and you surf a really great heat and you come out in the next heat and you surf pretty well, it's, you know, you're going to be judged kind of harshly.
Right. So the idea is the order as well as... Drew, what are you doing there?
Look, I don't take offense to that question you asked me, though. So.
Right. I just didn't like Alex's attitude.
You can take a shot at him all you want.
I don't like it. I don't like when this... I don't like... You know what I don't like? I don't like teenage boys. I don't like snotty teenage boys. You should be insecure. Your voice should be cracking. You should be popping a zit and crapping on yourself when you're calling the show. I don't like these teenage guys we call that act like... That call the show and act like we called them and woke them up. They're like, yeah, what, dude? I just hate those guys. Okay. Kelly Slate, our guest, pro surfer. We'll be right back.
Hello. This is your radio. Radio. LoveLine will be right back. LoveLine will be right back on 100.5 The Zone.
Hey, it's Sean and Jeff from The Zone's Morning Show. Listen to us every morning from 5 until 10 for great guests and even better prizes.
And now back to the sex talk. It's Loveline in The Zone.
Well, there it is. The best of Loveline. I want to thank Moby and Everlast and Mark from Blink-182, Jim Brewer and Kelly Slater for all being unwitting guests of our show tonight. I want to thank Engineer Anderson for working tirelessly putting this whole project together. So, until next time, this is Adam Kroller for Dr. Drew saying, mahalo.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.